Thanks, Ben. That's a bit of a hard act to follow. I'm from, so I'm going to be extremely, I'll play the straight guy. And what I'm going to talk about, because we've got some really good speakers coming up tonight, so I'm going to talk about it from the Fremantle perspective. And I want to make it really clear that City of Fremantle has never supported the right going through beauty wetlands, and that's been a council position for more than a decade. And continues to be so. And certainly one which I think certainly road infrastructure building in the 21st century shouldn't be going through wetlands. And I certainly think the others will make a very clear and strong case for that. I'm also not going to talk about the impacts on the Royal Fremantle Golf Course, the public golf course, or the residents of Palmyra, or those along Stock Road and Willoughby, because I know that will also get covered. But they are really important issues. Because ultimately, this is actually about what waves goes through our community. Or maybe it won't go that way. Maybe about the impacts of residents in Hamilton Hill and when on along Row 9 when it goes into the tunnel that's being talked about. But either way, once again, that will get covered. What I'm going to talk about is actually a bit that drops off the Perth freight link map. Because you might be aware that the Perth freight link actually doesn't get the freight to the port. It's one of the great bizarre parts about this. It kind of gets about a mile out and then it stops. Now that has some major problems for Fremantle, North Fremantle and East Fremantle, which I want to go through really quickly. Because it pops up just here. The Royal George Hotel is about where, just on the other side of Marking Street, is about where this road will pop up. Now if anyone who drives along that bit of Sterling Highway, you'll realise this, it's already a part of the current freight network that is pretty stressed. It looks like that a lot of the time. And what we're going to do, and I think Ben put this very nicely, is the magic things about our road is how they induce demand. They actually attract traffic. So what we're going to see is that's going to look exactly the same. It's just going to be even more cars on it. And you can see, I've just used Google Maps to map out this little trip down the port that we're doing now. And as you can see, it's a bridge and a road that's already under stress and at capacity. Now my real fear for this is that as we continue down this stretch, that we're going to see this either, there's two options. One, they leave it as it is, but it still funnels more and more freight and non-freight traffic down it. Or another, probably even more scary option is that it gets turned into a freeway that ultimately cuts Fremantle off from suburbs to the north and the east. And it's actually part of a really important part of a Fremantle community. This bit along Queen Victoria Street is a great little hub, one that's just over the last decade or so started to get a bit of a great vibrancy about it. And I think everyone agrees who's there is that it works really well. But it's also a really important entrance into Fremantle, and one that is increasingly becoming harder and harder to get across. Now, at the moment we've got about 3,000 trucks a day on a weekday coming out of the port. That's expected to ramp up rapidly based on port projections, where within a decade or so we're looking at getting close to doubling that. And certainly the ports left to grow until 2050 will have 12 to 13,000 trucks trying to squeeze down somehow this little bit of road. And I think the implication for Fremantle, and for those of us who want to try and get in and out of Fremantle, to the north or the east, are going to be quite serious. There's also a major question around the Fremantle Traffic Bridge's future. I met with both the Minister and Main Roads last week, who assured me that it will be replaced at some point in the future. But that money, which was in the budget a couple of years ago, to look at the upgrading and replacement of that, has come out and is in some future budget to be planned at some other time. But where that money is clearly going is actually to this. That is actually to the doubling of the Stirling Bridge. And it's very clear that this is actually the next part of the freight link that actually isn't being articulated yet, is that Stirling Bridge will double. When you look at this, you can actually see that, you can see the roads marked out. You can see where the green bits are, which are the public parks. Those other bits are actually road reserves. They're actually where they've planned to double this bridge. Now that will have a huge impact. and it'll also cost a conservative estimate for these works about getting the rest of the freight link into the port are $500 million. It could actually be well above that. So this is not just a $1.6 billion project, it's actually well above $2 billion. And one that, if this was built, actually would be a freeway that has the potential to cut Fremantle off. And also, actually, the beautiful areas like along the North Fremantle foreshore, like Bighorn Bay, will basically be under the double bridge. And heritage buildings in East Fremantle, like these, will be either severely impinged, if not knocked over, as part of the widening of that intersection. There are some really major impacts which aren't being spoken of. Now, as I said, these trucks numbers are predicted to grow. These are the port's own numbers about around what's going to come out, where the port is expected to grow at a very rapid rate over the coming decades. And actually, at such a rapid rate, and this is actually why we've always had a bipartisan approach to where we go from here until very, very recently. And that was around and out of the harbour. Now that has been lost because around this project. And where we're going to spend over $2 billion, I struggle to see what the benefits are. One of the stated benefits, which is talked about a lot, is 500 less trucks on Leach Highway by 2031. Now, going back to those numbers, by 2031 you're going to have more than double the trucks coming out of the port. 7,000 to 8,000 trucks coming out of the port. 40% of those are leaching, excuse the pun, onto other roads already. And they're going to continue to go down Leach Highway, and they're going to continue to go down other roads. And now ultimately we're going to see that this is actually not even good for the people in the city of Melbourne on Leach Highway who want to see their trucks. They're actually going to have, as a result of this project, a rammed up port, the rammed up trucks going down past the door. It doesn't even help those it's aimed at. It's actually not an honest solution, and not one that I can see is actually good for anyone. And it's also the biggest investment of infrastructure funds in terms of into this part of Perth we've had for a long, long time. And it comes at a huge opportunity cost for the kinds of infrastructure we really need in this area. 92% of people who use these roads with their cars, we actually need to be working ways of giving people alternatives to being reliant on their car and other ways of getting around. Light rail to Murdoch, light rail down to Copeland Coast are all things that we've been working on for a long time. And this, we would much rather see the project fund those kinds of things. So in my last minute, what is our preferred solution? It comes down to, quite simply around actually, capping the current port as soon as we can. We're looking at the moment it's 700,000 containers a year. I think in the longer term, a better community number is probably more around about the 500,000 mark. With some mining infrastructure upgrades that actually improve the amenity of residents along High Street and Stirling Highway in that area. That can be done for a pretty cheap cost. And ultimately, transitioning to what has always been an agreed upon bipartisan solution, which is an outer harbour that actually, and investing in Latitude 32, and ultimately investing in rail, proper design infrastructure away from neighbourhood, away from people where people live, to road and rail to that area. Which will ultimately mean we don't need, especially if you do Tonkin Highway, we actually won't need to invest in Railway, because the Tonkin Highway will be that bypass around. For me, that's a solution where everybody wins. And it's also a solution which Fremantle wins. So I'm kind of hoping that that's where we get to, and there's a real sense of optimism for me, because I think the evidence is with us, and seeing it all here tonight makes me think the community is with us as well. So thank you.